years aunt. And everybody just calls me Aunt Carol. But it's easy. We are here today to celebrate. To celebrate the life of a man who's called gentle, soft-spoken, assured, but seriously a family man, which is why so many of you have joined us today. And as you hear the celebrant talk about their experiences with Omir, you will know that one thing comes through. He was a good-hearted family man. And that's what everyone will say to you. And you can join in, because we're going to rejoice here. Omir did not like to be overly sad. So we're not going to be that. We know we all share our own feelings about the suddenness of our loss. But we know that that's not a choice we make. And so in all of that, we have to take heed in knowing that he had a good 58-year life. You can see that in his children, his wife, his accomplishments professionally, career-wise, and then the fact that he did take time to have fun and to let people know how he felt about it. So the one thing that you can all take pride in is knowing that he had his chance to say how he felt. And I'm sure you, like with me, he told you how he felt. We'll talk more about those things later, but now we're gonna welcome his immediate family, because Omir had a big family.
Paul Stanford.
And we were all part of it.
Thank you.
one of the things we often talked about was some of the poets. Amir was not a poet in many ways necessarily, but he and I would have debates about who he thought was, you know, was important. And so I selected a poem that I think, in addition to, is representative of who Amir was. It's a poem from one of our most significant African-American artists, poets. He was not of Haitian descent, but he understood the interconnectedness that we all feel. And this is called "I Dream a World" by Mason Hughes. I dream a world where man, no other man will scorn, where love will bless the earth and peace its path adore. I dream a world where all will know sweet freedom's way, where greed no longer saps the soul, nor avarice glad our day. A world I dream where black or white, whatever race you may be, will share the bounties of the earth, and every man is free. Where wretchedness will hang its head, and joy like a pearl attends the needs of mankind. Of such I dream, O world. Amir had big dreams, and he was willing to work for those dreams. And he did that. He did that, as you will hear from his friends and colleagues, as you will hear from his family. He never gave up. He never gave in. This is not the end, for as one of my dear friends said to me, if you say his name every day out loud, let's do it right now. Let's call his name, that in here we are here today to honor him, to celebrate him. Amir!
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 Amir! Amir!
And we will now have a special musical selection from Amir's youngest son, Mike.
Today, not for myself, or any of us here, my dad supported me and loved me unconditionally, and supported my dreams and my aspirations, and my music. Sitting first and foremost. So I'm here to thank you. There's some technical difficulties, obviously. This first song I'm going to sing today. My dad wasn't a very religious man, very spiritual, and believed in God, loved God. But I just didn't feel right to sing something that wasn't about him. So the first song I'm singing is kind of me singing to my dad. And then later something that I think he would sing to me. So this first song is a song. I've been so many places in my life and time. I've sung a lot of songs. I've made some bad rhymes. I've acted out my life in stages with 10,000 people watching. But we're alone now, and I'm singing a song to you. I know your image of me is what I hope to be. I treat you unkindly, Daddy, can't you see? There's no one more important to me. Father, God, can't you see through me? Singing a song to you. You taught me precious secrets of a true love withholding nothing. You came out in front while I was in there hiding. But now I'm so much better. And if my words can't come together, listen to the melody, 'cause my love is in there hiding. I love you in a place where there's no space or time. I love you for my life. You were a friend of mine. And there's no one more important when my life is over. Remember when we were together, but we were alone now, and I'm singing a song to you. We were alone, and I was singing a song to you. We were alone. And I was singing a song to you. We were alone, and I was singing a song, singing a song to you.
Some are not rated,
But we'll let the rated G's go on, but we want to have some, we really want to talk about the man who is able to understand and breathe for family and children like the ones you see here today. We're going to start with Tanya Tracy from Bank of New York Mellon, followed by Andrew Neck, who's a longtime friend who helped him get started in the business with MetLife, and then finally we'll go to Stuart Ward, who's a close friend, and he'll tell you about their coming together. Tanya? Family. Thank you. I am so blessed, and I hear from Andrew next. We know now.
I've been on there for 35 years, like brother. Still in shock. We worked together at four different places, starting with the transit authority and then with other places. He was the most technologically proficient person I've ever met. My career in technology, he was brilliant. He helped in my career. He knew everything about technology and he picked things up so quickly. Incredible. Funny story about the transit authority. When I first started back in the late 80s, early 90s, when the internet was just starting. And we were almost all the emerging technologies group. Back then we had a crotchety old fashioned kind of boss who didn't believe in change or new technologies. And Romero and I were talking about starting a website for the transit authority, which at the time, you know, was unheard of. No one ever heard of the World Wide Web or the internet. So we came up with a plan and we went into our boss, his name was George, and we presented our plan for building the first transit authority website. And as usual, Romero laid out a building plan for this. So we presented this to our boss, and our boss looked at it, and he said, "Are you guys kidding? The internet's a fad. We'll never go anywhere." So Omar and I looked at each other, rolled our eyes, and of course Omar and I, being the rebels and gamblers that we are, we started building the website anyway. And lo and behold, it became the first website for the Transit Authority and was very successful. In large part because of Omar. He was just so brilliant. And then, unfortunately, we made a couple of bad career decisions and a couple of good career decisions. But all along, we were partners in crime. I was just so honored to be his friend. And as we all know, Romero loved to gamble. We were in a pulp game for many, many years. Rob over there, sitting there with my wife, who's part of our game. And the last game we had, I think, was in February, at Rob's house. And of course, Romero took all our money. As usual. But one of the funniest gambling stories I have with Omar was back in the early 90s, I think we were in transit car in downtown Brooklyn. And we used to go into the Super Bowl box booths every year. You know, when you pick the box and the pool and whatever the score is, the final score you would win. So we went partners at some bar on Livingston Street in downtown Brooklyn. We weren't a regular bar, and we just saw that it had a pool, so Mayor went in there and got us the box. And lo and behold, we won. And it was a big payday, it was a couple thousand dollars. So Mayor went to collect, and I think we won like $3,000 or $4,000. So we came back with the money, and I said, "Wow, that's great." I said, "So what did you tip the guy?" And I hope he gave the bartender something. What are you talking about? I said, "Yeah, the typical customer." He says, "I gave him $20. I said, $20? And the guy, yeah, you know, I don't know why the guy was so mad at me. But he loved the gamble, but we went to Las Vegas and Atlantic City. We had so many good times together.
Distractions in the middle of the conference.
I want to tell you a story. As you know, he is my friend. We go to Craigslist all the time. Craigslist, we crash so much money in Craigslist. One day I'm in there on the TV. It's great TV. I think it was 65, 70 inches. I'm like, oh, ass. And the TV's on. He's like, no, it's not. It can't be. I'm sitting in the bench again. Yeah, look. Call the guy up. The guy's like, okay. Come on. You can come get it. Call Matt. Man, I need a ride down in the attic. Get this TV. 70 inches. It was 100, 200. So very, very light, you know. And the dude is like, so Matt's like, Stu, you can't get a TV for that price, man, but I'll take you, you know. Okay, no problem. We have been, you know. So we go in Manhattan, across the bridge, go to this luxury high rise. The address was right. Go to the doorman. We're here to see such and such. Doorman's like, yeah, he's waiting for you. We go upstairs. Open up the apartment door. The TV's right there with the picture that they sent, the same exact television. We turned to each other at the same time, like, this is real, you know? And I'm like, yeah, this TV. Okay. So the deal goes down, make a long story short. I'm coming back across the bridge, you know, TV, and everything. And I said, I'm gonna enjoy this television, you know? So I live on Seaman Avenue. Lives on New York Avenue. Long story short, TV went to New York Avenue. So I know you guys are paying for the TV, you know, and I don't know to this day how that TV went to New York Avenue. From the bridge to Long Island, I never saw that television. That's how I knew. That was my friend. We've been close before that, but that's what I knew. You know, that guy got, what? How old? How big does he? 70 inches. Oh my God. I paid dirt for that. You know? That was my friend. That's how I knew that was my friend. You know? You guys, my heart's going out for you guys. Anything you guys need, please, you go to them. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Amen.
Enjoy it. brother. At the time, we were very young. I was 17, and I was the oldest. So I played the older brother role. But as we came over to the United States, the mayor very quickly adapted, and I was still older, but I no longer needed to fill that big brother role, because what happens with every generation, there is a transition that takes place where the younger ones rise, and I'm seeing a lot of younger ones here. And I know some of you, Omer, he had an issue with Omer because he saw the future and tried to point it out to you. But what younger ones always do is say, no, 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 I don't want to see the future like you showed it to me. I want to be surprised. So I think over time, some of you have overcome those resistances and recognized what he was trying to do. There's a concept in the United States, when you get married, you start a new family. There's a slightly different concept for most of the rest of the world, that when you get married, you're adding on to your family, you're enlarging your family. And that was Omer, enlarging the family, not giving up, not trading, but adding. And Omer and I went to Manhattanville. We overlapped the year, and that was the time. That was my last big duty as big brother, teaching him how to drive. Once he got his license, that was it. But we even had a nickname for Omer, which most of you never heard. I cannot tell you where that comes from, but that's the one that from in Haiti, and I actually used it out again and use it, and I was always comforted in the knowledge that most people didn't know what the hell was, but you knew exactly where we were headed with that. Omer was next to my wife. Is the most stubborn person. And it was always a joy to see the two of them go at. But I've survived both of them. And over time, Omer stopped. He remained stubborn, but in a very different way, in the sense that there was less preaching. You would welcome somebody starting the conversation, and then he would go the full distance. Whereas at the beginning, he would start the conversation, come on. It was very aggressive in a positive sense. Aggressive in the way that you care, and you need to show it. And you need to make sure that someone learns from you. But As Martin mentioned, we have this relationship with Matt Jacob. André is not here. Claire is not here.
It's not here.
Robert is not here.
They're just a little bit delayed this last year, though.
Nixon is not here.
Cool, I just went and found it on my phone.
Most of these are not in New York. He is away from the other one before they came here. So this is a very difficult time, so I'm very truly happy to see so many of you here. I expect that many people, not because we can touch that many people, but because of the circumstances we find ourselves in. So thank you one and all, and thank you everyone who was able to make it. And I know that there are a lot more of you who wished that they could make it, and we thank you as well, because we know your thoughts are with and prayers are with us. I'll now turn to my little brother.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Thank you for coming. it is a great difficulty. And I'm trying to explain those words to my brother, Amir. As Amir stated, he was known as a Jamal. And it's a name that he developed in school. And that name came about because Amir was always protecting me. He was always defending me. Regardless of who it was. Whether it's outsiders, family members, my brother has always been there for me. And right now I feel lost. Because every day I spoke with my brother. And not one day has my brother ever complained about anything hurting him. Or he was not feeling well. And that Thursday was the only day I didn't speak to my brother. When Monique called me and told me my brother passed away, I don't know what to do. I feel lost. I was even trying to drag my feet coming here because I didn't want to say goodbye to my brother. My brother's a family man. He loved his family. And for Father's Day, Marjorie was out of town. And we discussed about, we always talk about different things. What he wanted to eat, and I was telling him. Unfortunately, given the conditions with this virus, I was free. Marjorie was out of town. And I was telling my brother, the circumstances have been different. I would pick them up. And we'll go sit at a restaurant and have dinner together. And that was the last thing that happened. Less than a week later, my brother was gone. Less than a week later, 4 days later, my sister asked me to escape to Marcus. And when she was Michael, which then I thought something was wrong. Maybe they had an argument, but when she told me my brother passed away, the brother that we were making plans, that when we go on vacation to Haiti, we go to different places and visit different places. You know, actually everything with my brother. Everything. My brother's always been there for me, supporting me, encouraging me. And now he's gone. Who am I going to talk to on a daily basis? Who's going to tell me? He was always very rational. You know, Omer was never judgmental. If he didn't agree with me, he didn't tell me he didn't agree with me. But he was always supportive of it. And he would always try to explain to me why he didn't agree with me. Or he would tell me about the corrective action to take. Like, you have a good idea, but it needs to be tweaked a little bit. And I admire and I respect that brother. I love them. You know, so many days I got up, spoke to my brother. I don't know, maybe sometimes because as a man, I tell my nephews, I tell my sons, I tell my sister, after we're finished talking, that I love them. But I guess my brother understood that I love them because I never got to say I love you once. But I always love my brother. Anything, I thought that all his children, that's what it was. And I no longer have him. I no longer have my brother. And I'm sorry, people. You know, I didn't even want to come here. It's surreal to me to see that my brother, my Achaba, the guy who's, as far as I can remember, always put family first. And this baby brother, to some of you guys, when we were kids, given that Omer had such a reputation in school for fighting, how would deliberately pick fight with me? I cannot tell you guys the number of times that I deliberately pick a fight with people in school. And me up, because I knew I didn't want you up, because sometimes it seems that I have that skill of getting under people's skin. And I remember one time this guy was bent on beating me up after school. And after school, I met him. He was ready to beat me up. And then man looked at him and said to him, you know, I know my little brother can be very annoying. And I don't doubt he got on your nerves. But you have to understand the terms of this fight. As soon as you finish beating up my little brother, you don't have to beat me up too. And this guy knew he couldn't do it. And he apologized and walked away. And my brother, I love you. And I want to thank you for everything, for always being there for me. I love you, Omer.
But me and my dad were
my dad was a lot more than that. To me, my father was a guidepost. He was someone that, I don't know, I could always talk to about things, and he would give me the guidance I needed, the thing that I was looking for, the angle of thought that I didn't think about. And that's something that I'm going to miss for sure. Him being there, being that person for me, is something I don't think I'll be able to replace. But it is something that I'll need from you all as a family. And I can't explain how much it means to me to see all of you here today, all of the love and support that y'all have given us during this time, and how much we'll need you going forward. My mother lives alone now. It's very difficult for me to say that, to feel that when I'm in this other country. But I just want to thank you all for being here. I want to thank my father for truly defining what it means to me to be a father. And as someone who had all these hopes, all these dreams, came to this country, you know, had all these plans, and he put all that aside, all of it aside, to give me and my family the life that he thought that we deserved. And that's something that I will never be able to say thank you for. I will never be able to truly show the appreciation that I have for him. So this time, all I can say is that I love you all. I love you, Dad. And just thank you. Thank
you. So, one of the things that I think has always been so characteristic of our family is how desperate our personalities are, how different we all are, and just how quite honestly funny it is to see us sitting around together and chatting and conversing and interacting. I have always been the talker of the family. A little boy, learned to speak early, and as soon as I did, I didn't really shut up, and in about 20 years, and I'm still going. I think one of the lessons that my dad instilled in me very early, and that I've carried and has evolved and grown with me, is the difference between talking and listening. We have one mouth, but two ears and two eyes and two hands to do the work. And in different conversations and different ways, my dad made sure that I really understood that. And not just heard it, because Marcus, I'm also very stubborn in a lot of ways. I get a lot of my morality and my high ideals from my dad. And so I never really knew how to reconcile knowing that I had things to say, but still knowing that there was more for me to hear and more to learn and more to see, more to do. And I think that was something that my dad really not just understood and tried to impart in me and my brothers, but that he lived that. My father is one of the most intelligent men I've ever met in my life. Well-versed and fluent in multiple languages, some not even human languages. He is well-read and well-watched and can give you anything from, a
Greek poets, or which he was named after, to, you know, whatever the latest kung fu, you know, pop culture phenomenon, big blockbuster movie was that he was watching on the Empire State. And somehow still I always knew my dad as this very reserved, very respectful, relatively quiet, you know, mild-mannered person. How is it that somebody can have so much inside of them, inside of their mind, inside of their heart, and so much ability to command a room and to command attention and to really make things happen, to have a dream and to define that dream and take the day-to-day actionable steps to make it happen? How is it that somebody can have all of that and still sit back and still leave space for this little short yellow light-skinned boy he called his son, you know? And what I've always taken to be about my father, one of the main things is that lesson right there, that no matter how much you learn, no matter how much you know how to say, no matter how you may be feeling, no matter how ready you may be to move on or move to the next thing or do whatever it is, the work that's been on your spirit that you're fighting so hard to accomplish, he always knew to take time to listen to others, to listen to himself, to listen to family, to listen to his elders, the people that he respected, and also the people that he respected who were not his elders. He put doing the work of building a family and building a community above himself and above his own health and he worked up until his last breath to secure a life. Side of the family just as much as he did his ear side. He loved my friends and my brother's friends and the people in the community and the church people and the teachers and the after school coaches and the people who made our lives what they were, like they were his own blood. I think my dad was the center of a community, and I didn't see just how far-reaching that community was until after he passed. And I think it speaks to who he was as a man to not tell you about his accomplishments, to not speak about who he was, but to show it through how he lived. And even as he's moved on to another phase of the universe, another phase of living, we move through this lifelong process of grieving, I'm comforted by knowing that the man who, despite all of our differences and despite all of the fights, and all of the experiences that characterize who I knew while he lived, I am comforted by the fact that I'll be able to spend the rest of my life living up to the man that he was and he lived to be. Mm-hmm. And if I can do or be even a shadow of what my father dreamed for me and my brothers and for the next generation of our family to be, it would be work well done. So,
amen.
Thank you, Dad, for just telling me the way, because if you knew, I would never listen to you. But for showing me. I love you, Dad. He's brown like he likes. So this was the late me. He says that I tease him because he's Haitian. At the time, Haitians were having a hard time. So he says, I'd like to meet you. He did. He came on a Friday. He came and picked me up in his brand new car. A little black Chrysler. My girlfriend whispers in my ear and says, he's kind of cute. So he leaves. We leave. We go. The day was a Friday, and it was Martin Luther King's birthday, January 15th, 1988. The last day, last year before the holiday, the day became an official holiday, which is the third Monday of every January, but this was the last one before the shooting. And he drove down, went down to across 23rd Street, just across 23rd Street. And so I thought we'd go to this club, and I can't remember the name of it now, but it used to be on 23rd, and everybody went in jams. And so I was like, well, okay, he knows that I like to go to your jam. What was the name of it?
Maybe the Shadow.
You wouldn't have called the Shadow name or something else.
Leviticus?
Huh? Leviticus was on the other end. Leviticus was on the other end. That was what I like to do. I like to go and dance. So it was really interesting. But he didn't do that. You know, now most first dates people won't take you to the movies, they won't take you out to eat, they won't. You know, were you all close, close? We turned out to go to a comedy club. I was hollering and laughing so much. And so when it was over, I said to him, how did you decide to come here? He said, well, I figured we could both have a laugh. And this way, if it didn't go good, it didn't matter. We both have a good time. And then we go home. I'm like, I'm sorry. I can't wait for that kind of idea. But it was thoughtful, and that was the thing. It was thoughtful.
family, immediate family, only if they have at this time, of course, a limited number of people who are able to be there with us. Finally, for those of us who will also be able to join from, we will have a short recast following the interment at Cortland Colonial Manor on Old Albany Post Road, which is also in Cortland Manor. Michael will now say, on behalf of the family, and as they said, you know,
I go crawling down the avenue. there's nothing that I wouldn't do. Go to the ends of the earth for you, to make you feel my love. To make you feel my love. To make you feel my love.
Seeking guidance and wisdom. Lord, we know not your plans. We know not the story of our own lives or the lives of those around us as you have written it. But we know, Lord, that as it is written, so it shall be done. And that your plan supersedes our earthly understanding. Lord, we loved this man. A father, a husband, a brother, a son, a friend, a worker, in this time of pain and grief, we focus on those things, Lord. We focus on the man that we knew. We focus on the story that he showed us. We focus on the love and kindness and grace and empathy he gave every waiting moment. We celebrate the life of Omer this year. We know even in this time of pain and grief and sorrow, as we move through with the rest of today's services and on to the rest of our waking lives, we know that the celebration continues forever. For Lord, you have taken him into your arms.
Yes, Lord.
Through your heavenly gates to celebrate the life that you led for all eternity. We know that he is celebrating with his parents, Lord, with his siblings who go before him, and with all those lives that he touched, even the ones he didn't see. Like a petal in a pod, Omer left ripples in this world. Each of us carry a piece of him with us through you, Lord. We ask that this day and every day, feel that peace, you hear it, you love it and nurture it, that it brings us warmth on cold nights, that it speaks to us when we want to hear his voice, that it lights a path in front of us when we're looking for the guidance we sought through him. Because, Lord, we know, as with you, he is in your arms. In the same way we sought guidance from him while he was living, we know you are an everlasting and eternal Father, one who will never leave us, nor die, nor forsake or misguide us. As we move forward through our lives, continuing to honor the life of Omer Desir, Lord, we ask for patience, love, kindness, compassion, hard work, and a beautiful smile. We thank you for the life you allowed him to lead. We thank you for the man that he became. We acknowledge that even when we are hurting and sad and confused, there is comfort in you, O Lord. These are the many things we ask in your wonderful, powerful, mighty name, in the name of Jesus Christ, who is the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Yes.
We do say, Amen. Amen.
Dispositions will take place immediately following the end of the service at Hillside Cemetery, Portland, Manor, New York. Family, on behalf of my partner, Mr. Daniel Paul, and myself, please accept our sincere condolences. We're honored to have been of service to you, and I pray that our service is accepted. I'd also like to say a very special word of thanks to my friend, Mr. Wheatwood, and his staff for allowing us to